speaker this afternoon is Gordon Ramsey. And Gordon became an anthropologist and ethnomusicologist after a varied career ranging from soldier to motorcycle mechanic and tourist guide. After completing a BA at Queen's University, he earned a PhD at Queen's based on research into Loyalist marching bands in Northern Ireland, completed in 2009. Since then, he's been teaching anthropology and ethnomusicology at Queen's, spending time during 2019 as a visiting lecturer in the Ramsey University in China. His research has focused primarily upon traditional musics in Northern Ireland, with a theoretical focus on the intersections of social class and ethnic identities in capitalist societies. He's published extensively on these and other topics, and his monograph, Music, Emotion and Identity in Ulster Marching Bands, was released in 2011. He's an active community musician, playing in marching bands and traditional sessions. And he's going to talk to us today about That's a Loyalist Tune, the Enaction of Identity in Instrumental Music in Northern Ireland. Thank you, Gordon.
Okay, so the paper I'm going to present today is in very embryonic form. I'm going to throw out some ideas, illustrated with YouTube videos, and look for feedback. There will be some clear connections to the stuff we've been listening to already this afternoon. I'm looking at music within the Ulster marching band scene. Brief introduction. There are somewhere between 600 and 700 marching bands in the six counties of Northern Ireland. So it's an absolutely extraordinary level of participation. Predominantly, almost overwhelmingly working class tradition. There is some middle class involvement, but not very much. Vast majority of these bands are loyalist, and over half of them are flute bands, because flutes are the cheapest instruments you can get. And bands, marching bands, of course, are entirely instrumental ensembles. There are no vocals. So how do marching bands convey political messages? And that's what I'm going to look at in this presentation. So focusing on loyalist bands, I've identified six types of music that they play. First of all, and most obviously, traditional Orange song. Most of which were composed in the 19th century. Now, the thing about Orange songs is that very few of them are sung anymore. The vast majority, although the tunes are still played, the lyrics, although you can find them online, are not known by contemporary loyalists. So very few Orange songs are actually sung by audiences. The exceptions would be the Sash My Father Wore, which we've already mentioned, which most people, everybody knows the chorus of that, many fewer people know the verses, and Derry's Walls, in which there is a chorus that is sung, although it's not exactly the traditional chorus. I'll come to that one in a minute. And there's a crossover between that category and the last one, which is traditional tunes, Irish traditional tunes, marches, jigs, hornpipes, etc. Because when people don't know the words of the songs, they're indistinguishable from other forms of traditional tune. There are loyalist songs of the Troubles of the type that Stephen was talking about. We'll have a look at those in a moment. There are football songs associated primarily with Glasgow Rangers and with Linfield in Belfast. We'll have a look at those. There are military marches and similar marches which were composed specifically for flute bands, often by working class composers. We'll take a look at those. And there are popular music and film themes, especially those associated with the popular music of the two world wars, but definitely not limited to those. And finally, as I've already mentioned, traditional, what we now call Irish traditional music, but which in the 1800s, when the marching band tradition developed, was simply the popular music of the English speaking world. Orange songs, Derry's Walls. The words that you will find in a folk tune collection or an Orange songbook. On the left, we have the traditional words, we'll fight and not surrender. Whenever duty calls, with heart and hand and sword and shield, we'll guard old Derry's walls. On the right, we have what the crowd actually says, from which pretty much all the historical references have been stripped. We'll fight and no surrender with every loyal band, with heart and hand and the flute band of your choice. Ye-o, ye-o, ye-o. And the significance of ye-o as a regionally specific form of celebration is displayed on this mural in the Ulster Sports Club on the High Street, once a working class sports club, now an upmarket pub. So Orange Song's not the obvious form of meaning that you would expect, in that much other scholarship has looked at traditional song as a way of passing on memories and historical memory, as Stephen was talking about, people wanted to remember their history. Well, a lot of people are not particularly interested in remembering their history. They just want a form of musical enaction which creates solidarity in the here and now, in a very local sense. Moving then to the Loyalist songs of the 1970s, and I picked a particularly interesting one here, which, like many, is set to an older tune. In this case, a tune best known as the Boston Burglar, and it's well known as that because it was popularised by Johnny McElroy in 1967, shortly before the trouble started. Loyalists know this tune as the Englishman's Betrayal or the Englishman's Command, and it's a song about the original UVF, the 1912 UVF, and the 36th Ulster Division, which fought against the Germans on the Battle of the Somme, and took enormous casualties. The argument it makes in its lyrics is that these men were betrayed because when they came back after the First World War, Ulster had been partitioned. Three counties had been given to the Republic. And this is an interesting song in that it not only challenges Irish nationalist narratives and the narratives of the British state, but also Ulster Unionist narratives that see partition as a good thing for unionism. Only insiders know this. And in fact, my band, Schenkel Road Defenders, plays this tune. We refer to it as Boston. That's what's called on the street. So insiders know the words of the Englishman's Command, but everybody else either hears the Boston Burglar, if they know that tune, or a generic folk tune, which was in fact used for a number of other songs before the Boston Burglar popularised. So it's polysemic. Different people are likely to take different meanings from this tune.
Doctor
selected by Rangers as a song that was played before matches, became hugely popular with Rangers fans, and Rangers is very much associated with Ulster Loyalism. There's a huge support for Rangers in this country, in Northern Ireland. The song made famous by Roy Orbison, composed by English composer Sammy King, who has performed it at Ibrox and released a charity version in 2011. The lyrics to this song have no political content whatsoever. They also have nothing to do with football, except for one line, "Step up and play," which is taken as a slogan to inspire football players, but also to inspire band members. Step up and play is a challenge, get up and do your best. And this is a Rangers song, but it's being sung in this video to support Linfield. So there's a very fluid crossover between the support of these two teams. marches with no lyrical content whatsoever could of course be associated with the British military, and to some extent that explains their popularity among the Loyalists. But these bands are also played by nationalist bands in the Republic of Ireland, often the same marches. So the meaning is complex, but important to the musicians who play them. Moving now to popular music, this is one of the probably the most contentious songs I'm going to talk about today. The Slick John B, originally a Bahamian folk song, popularised by the Beach Boys in 66, and almost immediately entered the repertoire of Loyalist bands, along with other popular tunes of the time. One band woman told me they used to play it with Boney M's Brown Girl in a Ring. Around 2008, a Belfast Loyalist resident in Scotland composed words to this tune, which became known as the Famine Song. And the guy in question posted his reasons online. He identifies himself as Bill, of Bill and Will fame, meaning a Loyalist duo performing around that time. And makes his argument that this tune is not sectarian because it's directed at Celtic fans in reply to some of their songs. However, the Scottish government disagreed and categorised this as a sectarian song because it includes the line, the famine's over, why don't you go home? Which the Scottish government saw as both sectarian and racist against Irish people. This is the Young Conway Volunteers from the Shankill Road performing it outside the Catholic Church in 2012. Filmed by J.K. McGee, a prominent Sinn Féin activist, Republican activist in the area. This sparked an enormous controversy. Supporters start singing along the words of the famine song, and at that point there's a confrontation between a band member and J.J. McGee. Shortly before this happened, a Rangers supporter had been convicted of a breach of peace for singing the words of this song in Scotland. The band were also charged with a breach of the peace and found guilty, but on appeal found not guilty, because they were able to show that Loyalist bands had been playing this tune for decades before the words of the famine song had been written, and that they couldn't control what supporters sang along to. However, that wasn't the end of the story, because within 6 months of the verdict, this band had ceased to exist, along with two other bands from the same area, which had subsequently become involved in the controversy. And that could really be put down to a form of control from within the community. The mothers at the Shankill didn't want their children going to bands that might put them in situations where they could be arrested or indeed provoke violence against them. I'll come back to this after I've shown the next clip, which is another example of popular music, but very different.
Thank you.
a straightforward appropriation of popular music. There's no Loyalist lyrics set to this song. The crowd knows all the lyrics of the original song, unlike traditional Orange songs. So the question arises in, why are these two appropriations of popular music so different? Why did Young Conway Volunteers do something so blatantly provocative when Don Lloyd don't feel the need to do that to create solidarity in their audience? And I think in part it has to do with the resources available to these different bands. Don Lloyd are one of the few bands who are able to attract middle class recruits, people with education. Pretty much everyone in that band can read music, can play sophisticated harmony parts. That with these powerful instruments, they can produce an impressive sound, even without amplification, that can fill this venue and get the crowd singing along with it. It doesn't need to be a Loyalist song to enact solidarity in the context of a Loyalist culture day, in which they're performing in front of what must be one of the biggest union jacks in the world. They've been preceded by other bands playing Loyalist songs. They've also played some marches and some other Loyalist tunes. There will be more afterwards. So everyone knows this is Loyalism. You don't have to emphasise it in every song. And this works perfectly well, especially as they think they know that the crowd's been drinking for some time before they play and will be in the mood to sing. So the band has no vocalist, but they don't need a vocalist. They know the crowd will give them what they need in terms of creating meaning in this song. Young Conway Volunteers don't have these kind of capabilities. They're from a marginalised area of a marginalised working class city. They have no middle class members, none of them written music, almost certainly. Even the bandmaster at the time was unemployed. And even on the totem pole of bands on the Shankill Road, of which there were about 15 at that time, I think we're down to about 8 or 9 now, they were near the bottom. So for them to distinguish themselves, open sectarianism is one way to do it. But it's a very high risk method, and it didn't work for them. It eventually resulted in the collapse of the band. I don't know what happened to her. Returning to the title of my presentation for my last example, I called the presentation, "That's a Loyalist Song." And that's the reaction I got when I played this tune in an Irish traditional session from a woman from a Catholic stroke nationalist background who was sitting close. This tune is a jig. It's called Mud Cabin. Fans know it's Mud Cabin. The little old Mud Cabin on the Hill is the full name. And you would think, therefore, that there would be nothing exceptional in an Irish traditional session. But in fact, it's a type of jig that's become very unusual in Irish traditional music. It's a single jig, as opposed to the diddly-diddly double jig rhythm, which is very, very popular. The single jig rhythm, which is di-did-di-did-di-did-di-did, has become much less popular. When Irish traditional music was primarily played for dancing, single jigs were played a lot. The basis of a single jig, the dance of a single jig, is a marching step. And the tunes were also used for marching because they have a great swing to them. But as Irish traditional music has become separated from dancing and tends to take place either on stage or in pub sessions, single jigs have almost completely fallen out of the repertoire, because they don't give fiddlers much chance to show off. So when this woman heard me and another band friend play this tune in a traditional session, she immediately reacted, "That's a Loyalist tune. I've heard the bands playing that." But just as interesting as the fact that she heard the bands playing it was that she hadn't heard Irish traditional musicians play it, because they don't play those kind of tunes anymore. So simply, by the rhythm of the tune, she was able to identify as a Loyalist tune. Now that happened in the same session, actually, in relation to another tune, a fifing tune which is normally played for lambeg drums. I think that was Open the Door. A guy said to me, me and my friend played that tune, and the guy went, "Cully back," referring to the village in County Antrim, which is at the heartland of the lambeg drumming tradition. And I said, "Oh the tune. And he said, I don't know the tune, but I know the rhythm. People were able to identify the political affiliations of a tune simply by the rhythm of the tune. So this is the tune in question. Decentralized scene, bands are independent, they're not for the most part affiliated to overarching organizations, and they're competitive. They're always looking for tunes better than the next band they're playing. They will look for new tunes, and as going back to certainly the 1970s, well, no, going back to the 1880s, bands have been adopting popular tunes. My band, for example, plays The Man Who Broke the Bank in Monte Carlo, along with Lily Sardinia, Laguna, I think the 1920s, that became popular. So these were adopted into the repertoire. The band likes playing them. They always get a good reaction from audiences, so they've stayed in the repertoire. Since my band was formed in 1957, I'm pretty sure they've been playing those tunes ever since they were formed. Other tunes where go in and out of fashion and are dropped and replaced by new ones. And that's an ongoing process. I remember tunes that have been popular, the theme from Van der Volk, if you remember that Dutch detective series, that was popular in the 70s. Chiquitita by ABBA was a popular one, which has now faded from the repertoire. So yes, the songs come and go. The tunes come and go in line with the taste of the audience and what's new at the time.
And can any song qualify?
Yeah. Loyalist bands will play anything that they like. And even including Republican songs, because I just put new words. A number of Loyalist songs have the same tunes as Republican songs. So there's really nothing that's off limits.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Gordon. Just in relation to Penny Arcade, I'd come across some work that Aileen Delane had been working on. So Aileen down in University of Limerick, Aileen Delane. So she's got this, she talks about soft repertoire. She talks about soft repertoires and the concept that she uses in relation to musics that aren't necessarily themselves political or even a particular genre, but they become enveloped by those that they're situated alongside. And I find, like, I've been using that in my work on Loyalist songs, and I found it really helpful. So she uses it in relation to her doctoral work was with Irish traditional musicians in Chicago, and she was doing a lot of work in bars and Irish clubs, where they would be playing overtly Irish music, but then also like sort of pub favourites type thing. But then those pub favourites, many of which were American, would become imbued, if you like, with Irishness because of their association beside these Irish songs and play. And then so much so that even when they were played separately within these bars, they would be associated with being Irish songs almost, you know. So for me, I think there's a lot of use in that designation. And the other thing I was going to say in relation to the YCV band parading outside St. Patrick's Church, I wonder, even though I rubbished it a bit in my talk, I wonder if this is where a musicological analysis perhaps could be useful, in the sense that couldn't it be said that if you actually did a proper musical analysis of what was being played, you could actually empirically determine which song it was that we were hearing. So for example, the musical pronunciation is different in the Fallon song and Slow Journey, the way that the beats fall, the way that these lyrics are enunciated. So for example, so if it's the case that the band is playing one or the other, that would be determined by the way that that's annotated on the page. And if the court had the illumination to ask a musicologist or an ethnomusicologist come into the courtroom and sit them down and explain, they can actually guide them through that process and say, well, this definitively is that, so this song or that song. Of course, social reality plays a role, but you would be able to say in black and white, this is that song or is that song, by virtue of where the beats fall and where the emphasis is. What do you think about them?
Yeah, two really interesting points there, Stephen. So the first one, soft repertoire, yes, it's a could be a useful idea, I agree. And there's a number of reasons for that. One is that people don't want political songs all the time. People want a bit of enjoyment and light relief. And, people don't want to constantly be thinking about the troubles. That's not why people come to band events. And something I should say about this band scene is that this is central to social life in working class loyalist areas. It's an affordable social life. Bands are the people who make things happen in loyalist areas. So even if you're not in a band, there's a good chance that a significant part of your social life will evolve around events that are either parades or indoor events that are put on by bands. Because that's the social life that's available to you. So soft repertoire, definitely. And Some of the gigs that I put on in Loyalist clubs are entirely soft repertoire. That's, so my band hosts an event on New Year's Eve, sorry, New Year's Day, it's an after party for New Year's Eve, in the Blues Club, the Linfield Supporters Club on the Shanghill, and no Loyalist tunes I ever played at that do, except maybe Penny Arcade, which is as close as you can get to a Loyalist tune. Because that's not what people want on New Year's Day. So yeah, soft repertoire, absolutely. The case for the prosecution, I think Young Conway's volunteer should probably be glad you weren't on the prosecution team for that hearing. I think you're probably right, you can determine what are the words in people's head from the way they articulate the notes. And I've actually seen this in band practices, where a tune was brought in as a Rangers song, and we were given a note to play, and we played it, and we played it quite well for the first attempt. I pointed out to the guy next to me, we didn't play what's written on the page. And he said, no, we played it the way it's sung, you'll never change that. So yeah, absolutely.
Well, if there are no more questions, I think all it remains for me to say is a big, very big thank you to all the speakers in this plenary session. I think you'll agree it's been a very rich panel today. And just also to say that there is some wine in the Morty room now until 6:30. So please...